On June 23, 1984, Kirsten Kostas was stabbed on her neighbor's front porch. She was pronounced dead at Kaiser Medical Center in nearby Walnut Creek at 11:02 p.m. Kirsten was 15. The suspect was described as a teenage girl, chunky but not fat, with shoulder-length light brown hair, driving a gold or yellow older model Pinto that appeared to be in poor running condition.
Where'd I come from? Genesis 1:26 and 27, God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. And in spite of what Carl Sagan says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. We came from God created body, soul, spirit. We did not evolve. We were stamped with the image of God upon us. Have fellowship with the world, with one another, and with him. Body, soul, spirit. That's where we came from. You won't have any problem with the evolutionists, you know your Bible. Let's stand to pray. I'll ask that no one move. This is a most sacred moment. Dear God, I'm a sinner. I deserve to go to hell. I've broken your laws. But I believe Jesus died for me, was buried and rose from the dead for me. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Save my poor lost soul. Cleanse me from my sins. One day give me a home in heaven. Let us help you. Our Father in heaven, help men, women, boys, and girls to do now what they'll be glad they've done one day when standing in your presence. Save that soul nearest hell for Christ's sake. Amen. While we sing, our pastors are here at the front. If you need salvation, if you need rededication, if you need a new beginning with God, whatever you need right now. If you want to join Thomas Road Church, if you raise your hands and pray for me, and you want one of us to go to a prayer room and privately pray with you, if your family needs help, if you have trouble today, you came here and God spoke to your heart, now let us finish the job. Let us help. Come on. Meet us at the front right now. From the balconies everywhere while we sing.
Last summer, my daughter, who was 12 at the time, and I took a train from Milwaukee to New York. We changed trains in Chicago, and my daughter bought a Rolling Stone magazine. Somewhere in the middle of Indiana, she ripped 6 or 7 pages out of the magazine and handed them to me and said she didn't want to read this kind of article. It only scared her.
Go ahead. Anytime you want to say something, just say it.
What are you going to tell the press?
You're a juvenile, okay? You're under 18, and the press does not get your name.
Okay. Don't you have to just tell them something or anything?
Yes, we'll tell them that someone...
Okay. Well, what are you going to tell the family? What are they going to tell the parents?
That someone has been identified.
And that's all?
Yes.
Okay, what I mean is, do I go to juvenile hall, or do I get to go back to school?
You go to juvenile hall, and then you refer to the probation department.
Well, could they decide that I stay there, or go to a new school, or...
They'll decide whether you stay in custody, or whether you're released, or what.
Okay. Do you have any idea what date they'll decide? And, that's all that goes on my record?
The courts will decide, right? Plus, it's a juvenile record. We need to go through a few details, and like I say, I think if we... I know it's tough, but if we could do it now, it would save you having to go through some things later on.
Yeah.
Did you call Mrs. Costas?
Yeah.
When was that?
Thursday night.
Do you remember what you said to her?
No. Just mainly, you know, I just said I was some girl, and that it was for a Bobby initiation. I don't remember what words I used and stuff. I just thought, I don't know, you know, just mainly told her what to tell. I don't know, just, you know, that's all. I said, you know, that Kristen, that the initiation dinner was on Saturday night, and that's what I told her, and it wasn't a big, long call or anything. I think she asked me what Kristen should wear, and I said anything or something like that. I don't know.
Did you tell her a skirt?
I don't remember.
Okay. Then what did you do?
I don't remember what I did on Friday. I remember on Saturday I had orientation at John Muir Hospital for being a candy striper, but I don't remember what I did that day.
Okay. What about that night?
Well, so I honked outside her house. I think, I didn't know which house was hers, but I think I honked at the wrong one. And she came running out, and she said, oh, it's you, or whatever. And then we went to the church, because she wanted to smoke, or whatever. And I didn't want to.
Then what did you do?
We just talked. We argued, not argued really. But she didn't think it was any big deal. And I just didn't want to. She made me feel real dumb about it. Like this one time I was around her and she really seemed to be putting me down. And I don't know, I felt really, just everything that had happened to me before, like all the bad feelings and all the bad things had come out. And she thought I was being weird because, you know, and she said she wanted to go home. And she just ran down the street and I said, I'll take you home. And she said, no. Then I went and followed them. Then we got there and I...
Let's go back, okay? Let's not talk about that right now, okay? Let's back up. When you picked her up, you said you beeped the horn.
Yeah. She said, oh, it's you, because she didn't know who it was going to be. And she said, well, I thought this was like a Bobby's initiation. I told her about Matt's party, and a lot of people don't tell their parents and stuff. So the Bobby initiation thing was just sort of so she could, you know, go to the party. She knew that there wasn't an initiation anyway, because, you know, she heard from other people that there wasn't.
Okay. She suggested that you go to the church to smoke some grass.
Yeah.
Okay. Then she walked down to the house. Did you run after her?
Yeah. I don't know if she was really... She was running, I guess. Then I was just standing there going, I don't know what. I didn't know what was going on. Then I ran after her because I was going to... Because she said she was going to go home. And I thought, oh, well, I'll take her home. And she ran down there and asked those people to take her home. And I said, well, I can take you home. And she said, no. So I went back and got in the car. And I think then I drove the car down from the church parking lot. And they were just pulling out of the driveway. And then I think it just, like, the engine died or something. I don't know.
Did you have trouble starting it?
Well, that car, you always do, so I don't remember. I just remember everything was... And I was driving really fast, so I don't remember if I squealed the tires. I think I did, and then I thought, That man is going to think I'm just crazy. I didn't know what I was doing. Like, I really didn't know. When I was starting the car, I didn't know where everything was and stuff.
Okay. So you followed them over there. Were you real angry at that time? Or were you trying to scare her a little bit?
I guess I was angry. I don't really know. I just got out of the car, and she was talking to that man or something. I guess saying thank you. And I think he was starting to drive away, and she was telling me to go away. And I just, you know, and I just got angry, and I did it. I didn't like, I ran up to her, and I stopped. She said something to me, and then I did it. And it happened so quick, I don't really know. It was like, it was, I was screaming, and she was like way up ahead of me, and she was running away, and I was running away, you know? I wasn't pursuing her. I was getting home, and she was getting away from, and I was just, I don't know what I was thinking. I just ran, I was running, and I got to the car. I just threw the knife in, like in the back, and I got in, and...
Okay, what kind of knife was it?
Like a kitchen knife. I don't really know. I mean, I couldn't take it out now if it were in the drawer because I didn't want to think about it or anything.
Try to remember what color the handle was, or the shape of the handle, or something like that.
It was wood. It wasn't really wide. It was wider than a dinner table knife. I don't think there was anything special about it. I just, like, grabbed it. I didn't think.
You didn't put it in the car before you picked her up.
No. It was like, I noticed it when I was getting in there. But I wouldn't know if the knife was under there. I was thinking of my sister Gina. And she always leaves stuff lying around. But I don't know if it was Gina. I mean, I don't think she drives around with knives in her car. But that would be one reason why it would be there. I didn't go into the kitchen and get it before I picked her up, though.
Okay. And then what did you do when you got home?
When I got home? I don't know. All these awful things were going through my mind, and I thought the police were going to be there, you know? I was just, like, waiting. I kept looking out the window. And then I took a walk with my mom and dog.
Where did you put the knife when you got home?
Okay, I can't say I didn't know what happened. I knew what happened. I just left it in my room. I came in and I got something. I don't know what I did with it, really. But then I put it in the kitchen the next day when no one was there.
Have you ever written anything down about this?
Yeah.
When?
Last Friday, you know, when I talked to you, there were a lot of things I thought about. And I wrote them down in plain sentences. And there's a note I wrote to my parents this morning saying I did it because I couldn't say it to them. I couldn't look at them when I kept trying to tell them, but I couldn't.
So Friday you somewhat suspected we were thinking you did it.
No, I knew you knew, but, I just thought you couldn't prove it because it's been so long. I just thought, well, even if you can't, you know, I have to do something, you know, because I just wish that it had never happened. I wish that I could do what I have been doing and just go on, because I've been fine in school, and I just blocked it out of my mind. At school and everything, everything was fine and everything was going well, except for it was always there, you know. I couldn't get rid of it, and that song on the radio, every time I hear it, I have to turn it off because I think of her, or people talk about it and stuff. But I was really good about blocking it out of my mind, and I still am. That's why I was able to go back to school this fall. That's why I can live through every day, because I just forgot it, because it doesn't seem real. It still doesn't.
I'm still having a little problem with the church there. What did she do that got you that angry?
Well, I guess I really should tell you the background. I have a lot of inferiority feelings and really bad feelings about myself. And I lost for cheerleader. And I didn't get in the club that I wanted to. And I didn't get on your book. I don't know, people sent out messages and stuff that I just felt had it. And just all that stuff. And she just seemed to sort of represent it. And she brought it all back. And like when I was talking with her, you know, and she never liked me, but I thought she was okay. And I just thought, you know, it would be okay if we were friends. I mean, we were gonna be in the Bobbies together and stuff. It was that thing, you know, that I couldn't change. And I hate that stuff, like losing at things, or money, or looks, or popularity. Things that are stupid. I mean, I always felt like I never have friends ever because I'm just like embarrassed about everything, and I don't know.
Did she ridicule you? Or did she do something to you there?
She just sort of put me down. I mean, she didn't say you're ugly or something. She just said stuff that made me feel bad. And so I remember one time we were on the ski trip together, and we don't have a lot of money and stuff, and we can't afford a lot of nice ski stuff. And I just had this really crummy pair of skis and some boots, but, you know, I was having fun anyway. And she made some comment about them, and just seemed like everyone else was thinking that, but she was the only one who had ever come out and say that. And I thought she was just gonna tell everyone at school that I was really weird and everything, and I was really scared, and I just didn't want her to be talking about me at school. And the way I called her up and stuff, it seemed really weird, and I was embarrassed, and I didn't want her to tell everyone. But it wasn't her fault. I mean, if you're saying she provoked me or something. I wasn't thinking of threatening her. I just did it.
Do you have any boyfriends? I'm trying to ask you something. You know what I mean?
Well, I like boys. If you're saying, am I attracted to girls or whatever, no. I sort of get a lot of crushes, and I've gone out with a lot of guys. I used to be a typical teenager when it comes to that, you know. I'm not the most popular one, so I don't have guys around me all the time, but I don't know. I've gone to all the dances and stuff, and I'm sure I would get asked to the junior prom if I ever end up going back to Miramont and all that, you know. And I think, I don't know, I like guys, but, and I think they like me too. I don't know.
What did you write? Do you remember?
I wrote something like that Kristen's parents deserve to know what happened or something. And I think I wrote down that I would rather turn myself in than have everyone know what I did. I also wrote down, I think I could kill myself if I wanted to. And I know I could, because, I mean, I probably never could have before, but look what I did, I mean, like to Kristen. I never would have thought I could do that, and I did it. And so I probably could kill myself if I wanted to. And so I saw that as an option. But I thought if I killed myself, I thought, well, I've already caused a lot of pain because I knew my parents would know. And so that would be pain because, well, I sort of made them feel like they were bad parents.
Do you still see that as an option?
I would rather die than ever. I mean, like one time in the office, Cindy said that when they catch the person, I think that what should be done to them is that they should have everyone at school know that they did it. And they should have to go to school for a week. And you can imagine what that would be like. And that's what it would be like for me if everyone knew. I mean, I know if people knew that just like 500 people would want to shoot me right now.
Is there anything I can get you right now? Or is there anything you...
No, but I kind of have to go to the bathroom. I think I'm going to be sick.
Okay, there we go. You feeling a little better?
Yeah.
Your parents seem very supportive. They're going to be a big, big help.
Yeah.
I have a couple more questions that I wanted to ask you about. Do you remember what Kristen was wearing that night?
Uh-huh. She was wearing kind of like fuchsia-colored shoes with polka dot holes in them. I remember because she said, "Do you like my new shoes?" when she showed them to me or something. I don't know. And she was wearing legging things like tights. But I don't know if they were tights. I mean, they weren't like tights. I don't know what they were. And a skirt and a white blouse.
Okay. When you called Mrs. Costas to set up the meeting, she asked you what she should wear. Did you tell her to have her wear a skirt?
I said something nice. I don't think I would have said, "Now, make sure she wears a skirt," you know.
How long had you been up at the church?
I don't know. Not very long, but kind of. I don't know. Probably half an hour. I don't know. It seems like we talked too much for it to be. I mean, we didn't sit there and talk and talk and talk, but, you know, it was like a quick argument, you know?
Why did you follow her?
Because I wanted to explain, you know, because she kept, she's going, "You're weird." And I wanted to explain, you know, that I wasn't. I wanted to, you know, be nice and, like, make sure she got home okay, you know, because she wasn't going to be driving with me or whatever. But still, you know, that's why. And also, I don't know, I was just thinking, I don't really know why. I mean, I do.
What were you wearing that night?
I was wearing, I don't remember if I was wearing brown shoes or, I was wearing white shorts with sweats on top and a purple sweatshirt.
Do you still have those clothes?
Positive, I still have the purple sweatshirt.
What about the shorts?
I threw them away.
Did you have any blood on them? Is that why you threw them away? Did you have any blood on you at all?
Uh-uh, and I don't know why. It just didn't get on me anywhere, and if it did, it didn't show. I'm starting to get, like, kind of cold.
You want my coat for a little bit?
Okay. I'm not that cold, but...
Have you ever said anything to anybody at all?
Oh, yes, I have. I told a priest.
A priest?
Yeah.
What did you tell him?
I didn't give him all the details. I just told him that I was feeling awful about something, and I just sort of changed the facts, you know.
Could you tell me his name?
I don't know his name. He's some priest at Union Church, but he's not really going to tell you anything because they're not allowed to.
Well, they are if you say they can.
Well, I don't know. I mean...
Do you have a problem with that?
I don't really want to. I mean, it wasn't like confession or anything.
You said before that you got angry and you just did it. Did you intend to kill her?
I didn't, like, threaten her. I ran up to her and I said, "Kristen," I said to her, like, "I was going to drive you home or something, you know." And so she wouldn't, I don't know. And she said, just go away. And she was banging on the door, and I don't know. She's so mean. I wasn't thinking, you know. It was like nothing made sense that I did. Or, I mean, I wasn't thinking about it. I didn't hesitate. I mean, I don't know. I didn't think what I was doing. I didn't think why. I didn't think. And it's like it was almost not, I mean, after I was like trying to get out of it by not saying it was me, but you know, I really feel it wasn't me. It was weird. It was the weirdest feeling I've ever had. It was exactly like I was watching it. I was hurting her, but And then I was thinking, I wonder what happened to her. And that's when I got home. I didn't know if she was dead or alive. And then I found out she had died, but not until the next morning. What happened was I was in the shower and the phone rang. And my mom said, talk to Gigi. She's on the phone and she's crying. And I thought Gigi was calling saying, Bernadette, everyone says you did this to Kristen. Tell me it's not true. That's what I thought she was going to say. And as it turned out, she said, Bernadette, someone's murdered Kristen, and, you know, and...
Did you know that she was hurt pretty bad?
No, I thought for sure she was alive. And I thought for sure she was going to tell everyone that it was me. And I was just waiting. I wasn't waiting, really, but, you know, I was kind of waiting.
Did you want to hurt her before? Is that what you went down there for?
Not really. I wanted to do something to change the way it looked like everything was going to be, you know. I wanted to say I'm not weird, but, you know, I regret it. I had dreams about her, and I remember all the mean things about her. But I couldn't ever think it was her fault, and I don't think there's any reason in the world that justifies killing another person. I just keep wishing I could push time backwards.
I think that's all. I see your parents are out there. In fact, we can go out.
Here's your coat. Thank you.
There were a lot of people after Kirsten was killed saying they would strangle the person who did it. Now that we know it was Bernadette, everyone feels different.
Hi, looking for a great party album? Well, Sessions has a new one called The All Nighter. It's got 50 of the greatest party hits ever by the original artist. Just listen. This giant four-record set has everything, from classic hits by the Beach Boys to current smash hits by Van Halen and Quiet Riot. The All-Nighter is also available on 3-cassette tape. You get this fantastic collection of 50 great party hits for just $19.95. Here's how to order.
COD and credit card customers call toll-free 1-800-247-7110. That's 1-800-247-7110.
Deuteronomy. Just before dawn, through the silence, you feel you could cut with a knife. Announces the cat, who can now be reborn and come back to a different Jellicoe life.
It's a funny thing about trying to tell the truth. When I began this story, I felt the pain of Bernadette so heavily that I overlooked the victim. When I visited Orinda, things became more real. The first night I was there, I hallucinated a dark figure in my motel room.
Thank you. about an inch on that ball, but I was right there.
Thank you.
There were 23 murders committed by juveniles in the Bay Area in 1984, over 1,300 nationwide. The mean income for Orinda is $97,842. The song Memory was played at Kirsten Costa's funeral. Bernadette attended. Kirsten died of 5 stab wounds to her upper body. Before Bernadette's confession, her father suggested that they all pray. On March 13, 1985, Bernadette Prody was convicted of second-degree murder. On December 16, 1957, Bernice Warden was found missing from work by her son. There was a pool of blood on the floor and a trail leading to the back door. The hardware store pickup truck was missing from the rear loading dock. Later that night, a male suspect from the community was arrested. Mrs. Warden's body was found at the suspect's farm. The Warden store is now Clark's true value. It's been 28 years since the shooting. The store is totally different with a modern facade. When I visited Plainfield, I couldn't get a sense of the murder, but the feeling of a collective guilt still lingers.
Who wants the misery and horror of war? All of the destruction brought about by the earthquakes, the volcanic eruptions, the tornadoes, and the hurricanes are just a drop in the bucket to the price people have had to pay for the propensity of people to beat each other to pulp and kill or injure one another in order to solve their problems. When it comes right down to it, warfare is in the mind and in the souls of people, exercising their normal, human, everyday disposition. People take potshots at one another, even if only by word of mouth, expressing what is deep in their heart, and then the seeds of war are sown. Somehow, the grim and graphic weapons of war and violence between nations become even more devastating and dangerous with the erosion of morality within the soul of humanity when people lose their sense of divine accountability and of the need for a healthy and abiding relationship with the Lord. What our world needs more than anything else is a healthy humanity with a cleansed soul, campaigning for peace when the soul is filled with bitterness, as it often is, between nations and within the human family, only prolongs and produces more of what it is trying to prevent or overcome. Selfishness, trickery, and duplicity originate in the human heart, coming out in torrents of words, in reams of print, and time and again, in violent actions that were predictable from the outset. Violence produces violence, and the dreary scenario begins all over again. The solution produces results even worse than the problem it was supposed to correct. Let's face it, without the knowledge of God and impervious to his redemptive power, humanity at its best is often at its worst. At great cost to themselves, people all over the world have chosen to forget and decide to ignore the reality of human sin. There needs to be a recognition of what sin really is and what sin really does. It robs people of the peace which passes all understanding. It drives them to seek peace elsewhere at all costs, even at the price of human life itself.
We knew him well, or thought we did. He's an accommodating fellow. He had a big smile. Why, just last summer, he drove my uncle to the hospital.
Throughout this dangerous winter season, don't subject your family to needless colds and illness resulting from uneven on and off type heating. Thousands of careful homeowners are taking steps to avoid this risk. They're playing safe by ordering Blue Coal, the fuel that gives off cleaner, more uniform, more dependable heat than any other coal. What's more, furnaces, parlor stoves, and cooking ranges in this part of the country were especially designed to burn anthracite. And the cream of all American anthracite is Blue Coal. The harmless blue coloring with which Blue Coal is tinted is your all-time guarantee of better heat at less cost. What's more, Blue Coal is especially prepared for home use. You can get it in the four popular domestic sizes: egg, stove, chestnut, or pea. Order a trial ton from your nearest Blue Coal dealer tomorrow. You'll find his name listed in the Where to Buy It section of your classified telephone directory under the name Blue Coal.
sweetheart from me. I remember the night the Tennessee walls. Now I know just how much I have lost. Yes, I lost my little darling the night they were playing the beautiful
Now, Mr. Gein, before we start asking you any questions, I want to tell you, as your attorney, that under the law of the state of Wisconsin, you do not have to take a stand and testify in this case. You understand?
Yes.
And if you don't take a stand and testify, the judge cannot come to any conclusions as to your guilt or innocence because you didn't testify in this case. You understand that?
Yes.
Knowing you have a right not to testify, what is your wish? Do you want to testify in this case on your behalf?
Yes.
Will you state your name for the record, please?
Edward Gein.
And where do you live?
Well, at present time, in Wautoma.
Now, how old are you?
56.
How far did you go in school?
8th grade.
Now, Mr. Gein, on the 16th day of November, 1957, where did you live?
In the town of Plainfield, on a farm.
And on this farm where you live, will you tell the court whether or not you had any rifles or revolvers or pistols?
Yes. One 12-gauge shotgun, one 22 Marlin repeating bolt-action rifle, one single-shot Stevens rifle, and one old style, I couldn't say, it was so old what type it was. Rolling block, I guess they call it. And an old 22 revolver, short barrel that wouldn't work, and a Mauser 32 automatic pistol.
Now, in the past, did you do any hunting?
Yes.
Did you at any time have occasion to put bullets in your pocket?
Yes.
Now, on the 16th day of November, 1957, would you tell the court what you did that day?
I got up at 6 o'clock, and it was snowing at that time, and it probably was half an hour till the snow died down. Then I decided to go uptown.
Now, before you left the farm, did you take with you any of these rifles or weapons that you had on the farm?
No.
Do you know whether or not you had any bullets in your pockets?
No.
Now, after you left the farm, where did you go?
I was going to get kerosene. I had a kerosene stove. I took the kerosene can and put it in my car. And I wanted to get antifreeze, permanent antifreeze, a gallon of that. So I took a glass container and put it in the car. And then I drove to Plainfield and stopped to a standard station to get the kerosene. After that, I drove to Mrs. Warden's place and parked in front.
Did you see any people in the area of the hardware store, the Warden hardware store, when you got out of the car?
Well, right across from Warden's was a filling station run by Spees, a fellow by the name of Spees. I'm sure he was out there talking with someone else. They always used to weigh deer there. They had a deer scale there, and the 16th was the first day of deer season.
Now, why didn't you buy the antifreeze at the gas station where you bought the kerosene?
Well, there was an advertisement in the paper a week before that there was a special on permanent antifreeze at Warden's. That same week, I bought 2 gallons earlier.
Now, will you tell the court what happened after you got out of your car? What happened then?
I took my kerosene can and I believe the glass jug at the same time and carried them in. No, I left the can. I had the kerosene already. I took the glass container for the antifreeze. She filled it up and I took it. I paid her and took it out and put it into my car. And then I went back in because I thought I wanted to trade my Marlin rifle for one that Mrs. Warden had in her store. So I went back in and asked Mrs. Warden if I could look this rifle over. And she said, sure, it's my favorite type of rifle. So I reached in and removed it from under the chain that was in front of the rifle. I asked her if it would handle all the 22 calibers, the 22 short, the 22 long, and the 22 long rifle. And she said yes. And I remembered that I had been hunting squirrels the day before, red squirrels. And I felt in my pocket, and there were 1 or 2 shells.
Did you put those shells in your pocket that morning before you left your home, or were they in your pocket?
They were in my pocket from the day before.
All right. Excuse me, Mr. Gein. I'm going to give you Exhibit 17 and ask if you'll show what you did that particular morning to the best of your memory.
If I remember how this works.
Well, try and show us.
So I took the 22 short and put it in the magazine. This here is the magazine, and there should be a slot here somewhere where the shot goes in. I operated, there she goes, I operated this action that holds the shell in the chamber, but I didn't have this lock, the magazine lock. Then this slide won't operate. I can tell when the shell enters the chamber of the rifle. There's a clicking sound, and there was no sound. But before to operate the slide, you have to pull the trigger to release the hammer. That releases the action. But after I operated the slide, the shell went into the chamber.
And then what did you do?
I couldn't pull the trigger because the gun would go off. I turned the gun in many directions looking for a release. I might have pulled the trigger, or it may have gone off by itself. I couldn't say. There was a sound, like a low-powered air rifle. Just a low sound. And Mrs. Worden was just standing there like she didn't hear. So I glanced down at the rifle again. When I looked down, I heard a sound like something striking metal, a metal can or something. I looked up and she was gone. I couldn't see her. And then I saw her laying there. And then I saw blood there. So it came to my mind, either the bullet had struck her when the rifle was fired, or she fell that way. I didn't know.
And what, if anything, did you do then?
I believe I laid down the rifle to see if she was hurt or what was wrong.
Will you tell the court whether or not at any time you aimed the rifle at the person of Mrs. Worden?
No, I did not.
And what did you do after you observed this blood on the floor?
Well, I better explain this. From little on, whenever I saw blood, I'd either faint or just about faint. So that is why I can't answer at this time.
What, if anything, did you do with the gun at this point?
I believe I put the gun back, because as I remember, I had to.
Now, do you remember what, if anything, you did with the body of Bernice Worden? What is the next thing you did when you saw her body on the floor, if you remember?
I'm afraid I do not remember.
Did you ever argue with Bernice Worden?
No.
Did you ever fight with Bernice Worden?
No.
Did you ever have any bad words with Bernice Worden?
No.
Did you ever see her away from the hardware store?
I seen her on the street, that's all.
Did you ever have occasion to go to her home?
No.
It's your testimony you never went out with her socially.
Yes.
That's all. I have no more questions.
Mr. Gein, before November 16, 1957, am I correct you had an extensive familiarity with the workings of rifles? But you're not?
With the bolt action and single shot.
How long did... When did you first learn to shoot a rifle?
Single shot, about 8 years old.
Were you taught the safety precautions and the use of weapons?
Yes.
Was it your normal procedure to finger the trigger of a weapon when you were checking what kind of shell it took?
Not always.
Did you ever do that before?
I saved the life of one neighbor boy. He crawled through the grass and he thought he had something in the barrel of his rifle. He looked down the barrel from the muzzle end, and the hammer was back on the rifle, and I pushed it away.
Well, that's not exactly my question. Did you ever handle a rifle like that before with your finger on the trigger when you were checking to see what kind of shell it took?
No.
You would never do that again, would you?
No.
Why did you do it that day?
I suppose because I had to pull the trigger for the first time to release the mechanism.
Now, the week before this occurrence, do you recall what you did on Monday or Tuesday?
I believe I sawed wood. I helped the neighbors saw wood. Cordwood.
Did you go to Plainfield on Friday at all?
No.
When did you purchase the 2 gallons of antifreeze that you already had?
That was the week before.
Where did you buy then?
Mrs. Worden's.
Why didn't you buy 3 gallons? Why come back a week later to buy the 3rd gallon?
Because it was a 2-gallon container, metal container.
Do you deny having a conversation with Frank Worden about the opening of deer season?
I didn't have. I don't remember anything about that.
You don't remember having a conversation? You might have had a conversation about deer season.
I'd say no, that I didn't.
Do you deny asking Mrs. Worden to go roller skating with you?
In a joke, I said, let's go try out the new floor. But I never roller skate because when I was young, I tried skate my brother had, and I fell on the floor and that cured me.
Did Mrs. Worden remind you of your mother?
I liked her that way. She was nice. She did have the resemblance of my mother. She had the same height and everything and had resemblance in the cheekbones.
Did you ever tell anybody that you remembered the circumstances of her marriage to Mr. Worden?
You see, Mrs. Warden was married before we were up in that country, so I couldn't say.
Well, again, this is not exactly my question. Let me ask you this. Did you ever tell anyone Mrs. Warden had stolen her husband from another girl?
I was told that.
And you resented that, didn't you?
No.
Do you know that the other girl allegedly committed suicide?
I was told that.
And you remember that day, don't you?
Right.
And you knew that in 1957?
Oh, I never thought of that at that time.
Isn't it a matter of fact that you held Mrs. Warden responsible for the death of that girl?
I don't believe I did.
You don't believe you did? You might have. Is that it?
No.
After paying for the antifreeze, you left the store, is that right?
To put the jug in the car.
Now, you said that you went back into the store to trade in one of your guns on this one.
Right.
Why didn't you bring that down to the store with you?
Because I wanted to try it out first. Check it.
Check it for what?
To ask whether it could use the three calibers, the short, the long, or the long rifle. Because I wanted a rifle that could handle all three.
When you went back into the store, did you tell Mrs. Warden that you were thinking of trading your gun in on that one?
Yes.
And what did she say to you?
How do you mean that?
I mean, what did she say to you when you told her you wanted to trade in your rifle on that one? Did she say something to you about being her favorite rifle? Did you testify to that on direct?
Yes.
Did you forget that for a minute?
You see, you confused me a little bit there.
Did she say that, or didn't she?
She said that before, yes, when I asked if it would handle all three cartridges, the short, the long, and the long rifle.
What did she say?
She says, yes, it will. It's my favorite weapon or rifle.
And you didn't believe her, is that it?
Well, I doubt if anybody would believe everything just by saying so. Especially when I was told that the rifle I bought before would handle all three, and it didn't.
What kind of a coat were you wearing that day, Mr. Gein? Do you remember?
Winter jacket.
Where were the shells?
In my overall pocket.
And you had put them there the day before?
Yes.
And you had been hunting squirrels the day before?
Red squirrels.
Did you shoot any squirrels the day before?
I believe I did, one.
Did you tell Mrs. Warden you were going to put a shell into the gun?
No.
The weapon you were going to trade in on this one, which of the caliber shells didn't it fire?
.22 long rifle with jam.
And you were interested in buying a gun that would shoot that caliber. The shell you put in here was a .22 short, wasn't it?
Right.
How would that prove it would shoot a .22 long?
You see, there's a difference in rifles. Some will take a .22 short, but no long. And some are chambered just for the .22 long rifle.
And you wanted one which shot the .22 long?
All. The short, the long, and the long rifle.
Now, you've gotten the bolt into the gun, and you're having difficulty with the trigger, right?
Right.
Now, demonstrate to me how you held the weapon as you were trying to work the trigger. I don't want you to turn, Mr. Gein. Show me, not the judge.
That's what I was just going to show you. You see, after 7 years, it's pretty hard to know exactly how I stood almost 7 years ago. Everybody should admit that.
But you do remember that you turned.
Yes. I may have been standing this way after I loaded, but I was facing you because we were talking, and naturally turned because I hate to point this at people.
All right. As you were bringing the gun down, you say the gun accidentally discharged, right?
I'd say that, yes.
And you saw Mrs. Warden standing up?
Right.
And then you looked down again, and you looked up, and you couldn't see her?
Right.
Then what did you do?
Went around the aisle and looked at her.
Was she face down on the floor, or was she face up?
Well, you'd call it face up.
All right. And you testified that you saw blood.
Yes.
Did you see a lot of blood?
Just blood. I couldn't say how much.
When you went over and looked at Mrs. Warden's body, did you know she was dead?
No.
Did you think to get a doctor?
I'd say no to that.
Did you think that there was any connection between the fact that you had been handling that weapon and its discharge and the fact that she was laying there on the floor with some blood?
Yes.
Did you move Mrs. Warden's body?
That's where I can't remember too well.
Did you take her out to the back of the store where the truck was?
That I don't remember.
On the night of November 16th, 1957, when you were arrested, did you tell Deputy Dan Chase about what happened in Mrs. Warden's store?
At the jail, at the Wautoma jail.
You didn't tell him anything about this, did you?
I believe I tried to, but they wouldn't listen.
You say you told them that you put in the 22 short and all those things.
Yes.
You testified that ever since you were a little boy, the sight of blood caused you to black out?
Yes.
Is that animal blood as well as human blood?
Well, it would be the same.
When you were hunting for squirrels or deer or animals, did you black out when you would see blood?
I didn't hunt deer.
Well, the squirrel that you shot, the one squirrel you shot the day before, when you shot it, did it bleed?
Left it lay where it fell.
Did it bleed?
I didn't go see.
Because you were afraid you'd black out if you went to see it?
Couldn't answer that.
Did you ever dress an animal and prepare it after killing it?
My mother done that.
Were you ever present when that was done?
Seldom.
On occasion, were you, though?
Right.
Did you experience this blackout when you would see any blood when your mother was doing this?
When we'd butcher, I always walked out in the field or something like that, away from it.
Your mother died in 1945, is that correct?
I believe so.
From 1945 to 1957, did you ever have occasion to butcher any animals, small or large?
No.
Do you deny that you mutilated Mrs. Warden's body?
I don't remember.
Look at these pictures, Mr. Gein. Do you remember that?
Some of these pictures.
You remember some of these pictures? Do you remember what these pictures portray?
I know what they portray, but I don't remember seeing anything like this.
You don't remember seeing that at your farm? Do you remember putting Mrs. Warden in the truck?
No.
So, you don't remember. Mr. Gein, have you experienced this type of amnesia before? Do you know what I mean by amnesia?
When I was the Central State, to give a little example, I wheeled in a patient to be examined in the operating room. He had a rectal examination, and they put in an expander which caused bleeding, and I almost passed out.
What is the next thing you remember that day after the gun went off?
That would be when this Darlene Hill and her brother Bob and her little brother came over to my place. That's the plainest I can remember.
What time was that?
That was right after 12 o'clock, I'd say.
So I'm correct that you do not remember any events that transpired between approximately 8:30 in the morning and 12:30 in the afternoon?
Right.
And you don't remember doing what those pictures imply?
No.
I have no more questions.
I was 14 years old when Bernice Warden was killed. I was walking home from Steuben Junior High School when I saw the headline on the Milwaukee Sentinel, Cannibalism in Wisconsin. Mrs. Warden's heart was found in a saucepan on the stove, but cannibalism was never substantiated. Thank you. Ed Gein never confessed to purposely killing Bernice Worden. He, however, did confess to the murder of Mary Hogan, who mysteriously disappeared from her tavern in 1954. She was similarly shot through the head, and a mask made from her face was found in Gein's home. Gein was found innocent of killing Bernice Worden by reason of insanity in a trial that lasted 11 months. He spent the rest of his life in mental institutions, dying of cancer on July 26, 1984, at the age of 77.